Well, join me today at the fabulous Bankend Fishery, where I'm going to be talking about feeder fishing using braided main lines. Now, braid is something that a lot of anglers don't always get their head around. They can't quite understand how to set it up, why they should use it, and when they should use it. I know from all my feeder fishing that I've done that braid can bring me a massive advantage. So I'm going to run through all the things you need to know about feeder fishing with braid. So today's session is all about trying to catch a mixed bag of fish. I'm looking for roach, skimmers, maybe an F1 or two. So I need a ground bait that's gonna suit that. Now, it's probably no secret, you know I love that F1 dark and Thatcher's combination. It is a brilliant combination that I've used a lot with a lot of success. But here at Bankend, I come quite a bit and do quite a lot of fishing, sort of pleasure fishing and practicing and just enjoying the fishing here because it's such a nice venue. And to do that, I just wanted something easy, and I started using the Super Suite. It's basically in a kilo bag, which meant I could just pick up a bag and come here and fish. And I've absolutely emptied it every time I've used it, and I've also used it in the Oaks pole fishing as my pole fishing mix with the same principle, really. I didn't want to mess about with the combinations. I just wanted to pick up a bag. So this ground bait is incredibly sweet. It's got a lot of that crushed dark expander in anyway, so it makes a perfect combination. So being a kilo bag, I'm going to mix the full bag up for this session today. It smells amazing. It's got a beautiful, beautiful caramel type smell, which is absolutely lovely. Just pop that down there. The old faithful drill. Now for the feeder, and this is something that's really big for me. You've probably seen me mix ground bait a lot before where I over wet it and things like that. I don't do that for feeder fishing. I just want a ground bait that is damp enough to hold itself together, possibly on the dry side. And that means that I can play with it throughout the session to change the consistency so the fish react accordingly. And I'll show you how to do that when we get on the box. So just to start with, that's this whole kilo bag. I'm just gonna put probably, this is just a bit more than a pint, so about a pint of water into that mix is going to be spot on. So just quickly drill it up. Little bit on the damp side, but that's going to come around absolutely perfectly and be slightly dry when I'm finishing. See there, it's slightly damp. I literally will leave this now for 20-30 minutes and we'll see it'll almost be bone dry. And that's as much ground bait prep as I need to do. The only other bait I would like to prep when I get straight to the peg is a few pellets. So I've got the Pro Feed in 2mm. I'm going to put a few of these through my feeder today just to try and hold those skimmers in the peg. So I've just put half a pint or so in this bait tub. And I'm going to put enough water in there. Just been reminded how cold the water is, by the way. I'm going to put enough water in there to just about cover those pellets, and that's it. I'm just going to leave those, let them soak that water up. Got to remember, I'm not molding these round a feeder or anything like that. They're just going to go in with the feed, so I just need them to soak the water and be nice and soft. So by the time I start fishing, they should be it. And that's it for bait prep. Can leave that now, come back and riddle it in about half an hour's time, and no doubt I'll have the perfect ground bait. Well, just before we get into a bit of the detail, I'm going to kickstart the session off with a little bit of bait just to let it settle down. Just put a little 30 gram medium rocket feeder on here, one of the plastic ones. And the reason I've done that is because it's quite deep here. It's around about 12 foot deep. I've sticked up the rods at 24 meters. And 24 meters is a nice distance on these lakes. It's a distance, and because I use the sticks, I know that it's a nice distance to fish. It's into the main depth of the lake. It's just a nice balance. So I'm gonna put three or four, probably four feederfuls in today. I'm fancying it for a few bites. And I've, from a recent session, I had a few old squats left, so I brought those along. I'm just gonna put a little pinch of squats and a pinch of micros in each feederful. I'm not gonna be particularly accurate. I've picked a peg on the far bank. I'm just gonna cast in and around that area. You can see on this peg where I am, the pegs are quite big. So just gonna sort of walk a couple in the middle, one left, one right. I just wanna create a little area of bait. So You'll notice here when I cast in, hits the clip, down it goes, and just, it's gonna take probably 5 seconds there, 4 or 5 seconds to get to the bottom. So I'm gonna give that a little shake, just empty out the feed, empty out that bit of bait. And the next couple of chucks, I'm just gonna empty those out a little bit earlier, just on the way down, probably just give a little bit of a spread of bait. So again, a few squats and a few pellets, really loose. I haven't squeezed that in tight at all. I'm not bothered. I just want a bit of bait all over the place, to be honest. So just give that a nice little shake. I'm trying to create an area over which I can hold the fish. I'm not looking to fish on a sixpence. The old saying goes, you can't catch a load of bream on a sixpence. So we're gonna try and see, put that into practice today. Couple more feeder fulls. I'm gonna chuck this one a little bit to the left. That's really nice. Again, just give it a bit of an empty. All I'm trying to do, get those fish searching, get those fish looking, smelling that ground bait. One more, just for luck, I think. Just a few pellets in this one. I'm not too fussy, and that should be absolutely perfect. So let's talk through the detail of the setup and when and why I might use some braid. So the major benefit with braid is that there's absolutely zero stretch in it, nothing whatsoever. So everything that you do with the rod is exaggerated and felt directly through the rod into your hand. So control of the feeder, feeling of the fish while you're playing them, bite indication is all magnified because there is no stretch from the mono. And I don't think it's until you actually put braid on that you realize how much normal mono stretches. There's an incredible amount of stretch in that line, which is great when you're on a carp venue or big F1s and your rod's pulling around on a method feeder, absolutely no problem. Mono is by far the best line to use. When I'm out here today, and I'm looking to catch roach, skimmers, maybe an F1, I need bite sensitivity to be at a premium because I'm gonna fish with a traditional style feeder. Now, this is also the case on a lot of big reservoirs. You know, when we go abroad and fish on matches, anywhere where you go on a big natural venue, particularly venues that you can use barbed hooks, it's very good. Now, here today, I'm gonna use barbless hooks. And with braid, you just gotta be a little bit careful because obviously, the banging of the rod will be completely magnified by that lack of stretch. Now, because of that lack of stretch, using a shock leader with your braid is probably the best way to go about it. I have done some fishing for roach and small fish when I fish with braid directly. So maybe when I'm fishing venues such as Tamar on the Feeder Masters final, and I was catching lots of small roach, I actually used the braided line straight to my feeder, because there's absolutely no stretch whatsoever. And that means that I could see those bites, I could see the indications, and it meant I could pick up on the roach quickly. And I was only fishing around 10, 12 meters out, so that was okay. But generally speaking, when I'm fishing 20, 30 meters, I prefer a shock leader. It just means that I haven't got that risk of breaking my rod or damaging anything, because I've got that little bit of cushion and I've got that little bit of give in the rig, so I can still get all the benefits of braid, but there's a little bit of forgiveness in that shock leader, particularly when I've got fish under the feet. So what do I mean by a shock leader? Well, it's quite straightforward. On the reel itself, I've got 012 absolute feeder braid. Now, I always opt for 012 whenever I'm fishing short distances. You can get absolute feeder braid in 08, 0.10 and 0.12 diameters. And 0.8 and 10, they're lovely, especially if you're going to be fishing 60, 70 meters, you might see a benefit with fishing with a thinner braid. But for me, the 0.12 for most of my feeder fishing means an extra bit of thickness definitely helps me not suffer as many tangles and not suffer as many problems. That's incorporated with a shock leader. Now, today I've used 8-pound sinking feeder mono. That may seem like a really strong line, but I want something that's very durable. I want to be able to use it lots of times. And I've actually attached 7 meters of shock leader onto this braid directly. And when you put that onto the braid directly, the benefit of that is it's a very small knot. It comes through onto the reel and I've got that 7 meters of line at the foot of the rig. Let's take a little look at how I fix that shock leader. So I'm going to fix this shock leader now. Here's the braided line. I've run this all the way through the rings already, and here is the sinking feeder mono. So it's really quite straightforward. I always use the same length of shock leader. I've read lots of different things about, oh, you know, 4 or 5 turns on the reel, different lengths of rod. The reality is the shortest rod you're probably going to use is 10 and a half, 11 foot. The longest is 13, 13 and a half foot. I'm not bothered about a slight difference in the length of the rod when it comes to my shock leader. So one thing that I like to do is keep everything the same. Then I can even carry a few spares if I need to. So holding the line on the end, all I do is pull off a length of line like that. And I do that 4 times. Now I've measured this probably about 20 times in my life, and every single time it comes up the same length, it's 7 meters in length. All right, I'm not quite 2 meters across. So 4 of them, that gives me the distance there. So just gonna trim that off. Attaching this shock leader is really straightforward. Now there's lots of different ways to do it. You can use a loop in the braid and tie a blood knot. You can use different types of grinner knots and things like that. But a knot that I've started using and introduced to quite a few people is one of the easiest knots to tie in fishing, and that is a water knot. So all I do, I've got this braided line here, and I just take the mono in the opposite direction. So you can see I've got the 2 pieces of line together with a tag end of the braid this way and the tag end of the mono that way. And all I'm going to do is just form a loop with this line. So a nice big loop, and I need to pull this shock leader through this loop with the tag of the braid 3 times. Now obviously this is 7 meters long, so there is quite a lot of line to pull through, but you can see it's relatively quick. I'm just sort of trying to do it quite slowly to show you. That's 1. Pull that through there. I just need to do that 2 more times, and provided you're doing this in an open environment, you're not going to worry about the line getting caught on anything, so it's dead easy to do. That's 2. Pull that through a 3rd time. It's even a bit windy here today, so it's not ideal conditions, but it's so easy to do. I usually do this at home, by the way, in the garage or something like that. And you can see there, it's gone through 3 times, basically a big granny knot. But the water knot means that the 2 lines are sort of embedded together. Wet those up. As you pull it down, you can see them come together nicely, and you can really pull these together tight. All right, I really do pull these together nice and tight on the limit. Really get hold of it and tie it. Now when you're trimming braid and things like that, you do need some good scissors, so I always use my braid scissors here. You can't possibly cut braid without a good pair of scissors. It's impossible. And I really do trim these tags really tight right against the knot, because that knot is so tightened down on itself that it just isn't going to slip. So if I do this one on the other end. And again, this is the mono now I'm doing, and I'm leaving nothing at all. Possibly 1/4 of a millimeter, that's it. I don't know if we can get in on that. Look how neat and tidy that knot is. Absolutely tiny, rock solid and tiny. It's not gonna let me down. If I snap off with a shock leader or something throughout the day, I'll just re-tie one back on, and in matches I've got them ready to go. But for me, if I've got the time to do the knot, it's a quick knot to do, it's the strongest and smallest knot to do, why would I not do it? That means I've now just got the mono on the rod and I can fix the rig on. Let's have a little look at that rig. So with the shock leader on, I'm going to talk a little bit about this rig that I'm using. Now, this is probably isn't new to a lot of you, but if you read and keep up with sort of things that are happening, but if you don't, this might be of interest. And it's a rig that I've used with great success for probably just over a year now. As with anything in fishing, it sort of develops and things come on. So it's dead simple. On my main line here, I've got a link swivel, which means I can change and put on any feeder that I need to at any time. And then as I get down here to the business end, I've actually got a length of 8-pound power gum. Now, I've attached this power gum to the main line by using that same three-turn water knot that I showed you with the braid. Very quick and easy, especially when you've only got about 8 inches of power gum to tie. I've put a small stot. I can actually just slide this off here, I think. Look, I've put a small stot here, number 8 stot, behind that knot, just to give a nice flat edge for my swivel to sit against. And then to give the whole thing a little bit of protection and anti-tangle, I've put a 1 inch length of 1 mil silicone, which I can just, I'm probably just blocking you off there, but I'm going to slide this over and then you'll see it. So there you can see, look, I can just slide that silicone over the knot and the stot. The swivel can sit against the stot, and the beauty of that is, look at that, just kick off amazingly there. Now this power gum has got a little bit of stretch in. Now the beauty of this is when you get a bite from a fish, the power gum's not stretchy enough to show any difference in your bite. So it'll register straight through your rig into the tip. When you hook a fish and you pull against it, the power gum's actually got stretch in it. So you know that time when you've got that 2-pounder on and it just gives that extra kick? You've got that little bit of reliability in the power gum, especially with light lines. I also told you today there's a chance of an F1. If I catch an F1 today, this bit of power gum's gonna save my rig. So having that there is perfect. And I've just got a small knot, literally the tiniest single overhand turn knot. And just like you connect line to a pole rig, where you pull the line through and loop it behind the knot, that's exactly how I connect the line onto this piece of power gum. I've actually put a tiny bit of silicone on there just to slip it over. It actually sounds a little bit more faffy than it is. It's very quick and easy to tie, and it's very neat to use. And it's a rig that I've been using with my feeder fishing for ages, and with braid, it's particularly effective. I'm not so fussed about it with mono, even though I still have used it with mono, but definitely with braid, this is a must-have rig to use. So let's look at the feeders and how we're going to approach this session. So that's the setup. As you can see, it's dead nice. I've got the 11-foot Supera with me here as well, the SL version, nice and soft. It is important to have a nice soft rod when you're fishing with braid. Got a 3/4 ounce tip in. I'm going to start with this sort of medium plastic bullet feeder, which for me, the reason I'm going to start with that feeder is because it's a deep water. I don't want to chuck a tiny little feeder in. I want to make sure I'm sort of starting off with a bit of attraction. So I'm going to start with this bigger one. I've got 2 maggots on my hook, size 16 SFL. Just going to plug that ground bait in, nice and loose to start with. Try and get a bit of attraction in there. We're ready to go. Let's do some feeder fishing, see how we get on. Looking forward to it. Looking forward to my first cast. Let's have a look. Spot on. Now, when you're fishing with braid, rod nice and low while the feeder's sinking. You want to get that braid under the water. It doesn't matter what braid we're talking about, braided lines float. Okay, they're light materials that trap all your line, trap air in them, and they float. Even when they've got all the water in them, they still float. So don't be under any illusions that they're not going to float. I am going to use my double rest because I absolutely love a double rest. So pop that up there like that. That is superb. Not going to do that though. That's better. I can just adjust the height here. Oh, look at that. I can tweak my tip up. Now, once I get going, once I get into it a bit, I'll probably fish with the rod on my knee because I'm expecting bites to come a little bit more regularly. But to start with, I'm just going to put it on the rest. I need to be patient to start with. I should get the old stopwatch out. Preset that. I appreciate that probably just missed about 30 seconds there, but never mind. Now, with braid, because there isn't the stretch, it sort of wafts in the air. It doesn't sit and tighten itself up like mono does. So you have to keep tweaking your reel handle. And it's something that I like to do all the time. These extremities are perfect for it because they're a nice slow retrieve. So you can just tweak the handle. And I just keep that tiny, tiny little bend in the rod. If the braid starts to settle out and effectively that tiny little bend drops back and isn't in the rod, then I can just tweak that handle again and just tweak it up a little bit more. I might have even had an indication there while I was doing that, which would be great. It's been about 15 minutes since we put that bait in, just talking you through the setup and what have you. So the bait has had a little bit of time to settle. It's had that 15 minutes, but let's see what sort of reaction we get. You don't want to over tighten the tip when you're fishing with braid. When you're fishing with braid, if you've got a really tight tip to the fish, you've got to almost imagine that line is like a bowstring, like a guitar string, tight to the feeder. So when the fish picks up the bait, it's got a lot of resistance there. So with braid, I always like to have the absolute minimum possible bend in the rod. That's why I've got this flat rod rest on as well. I can just tweak the rod very slowly, and you can see there I've got barely any bend in the tip. Of course, some days there's a big strong toe on the lake, and when there's a big toe on the lake, you've got no choice but to use a tip that's really bent round. Whereas how I'm fishing here today, I can just have that tiny, tiny little bend in the tip, and that makes it absolutely perfect for what I'm looking to do. You've got to remember there's no stretch. Keep saying it, but it's very important. There's no stretch in that braid, so I can see everything. I can actually see some tiny, tiny little indications on the tip. I can see it moving very slightly, which is a great indication that there's hopefully a few fish have started to come over that ground bait. But by having that really slack, I can see and wait for a positive indication. I'm not going to pick up at anything. I am going to wait for a positive bite, a real tug on the tip, because there's no stretch. So I'll be able to see everything and pick up straight into the fish. Well, really interesting start to the session. There's been a few fish there to start with, but these sort of roach and little skimmers, I wouldn't say it's been absolutely solid, but I've had a few bites, I've had a few indications, and I'm just trying to feel my way into the session really. It's very, very early spring and it's really cold today, and I just think the fish aren't quite settled down yet. So I've just actually put a winder feeder on, because I always think with a winder feeder I can get a bit of a slower release of my bait, and I think that that's helping me just get a few bites. I'm always a big fan of chopping and changing my feeder and mixing it up, and I've just had a couple of bites quite quickly with that. The beauty is, of course, I can see everything with that braid. I'm seeing the indications really fast. I've had two little skimmers, two little roach, and every time I can actually see exactly what's going on. The tip sort of little tiny movements. I know they're not bites, but the bites are really jagged. And of course, the thing I love about braid is when you pick up on the rod, you get to feel every kick, every fin movement, everything that's happening there. I just felt something while I was talking to you, actually, so maybe a roach has picked that up early. I put the rod on my lap, incidentally, because I am getting little movements there straight away. Yeah, I put my rod on my lap because those little movements and those fast bites from those smaller fish, you do need to react to quicker. So again, a benefit of braid, seeing everything, I can react quicker, because obviously the second I move the rod, it's straight directly into the feeder and it moves the feeder, and it just means I can pick up on those bites as quick as possible. There's a lot of little indications there, this chuck. I think there might even be one on. So let's just try something here. When I think there's one on, sometimes I can actually move the rod a little bit. Just missed him. But I moved the feeder and I moved the rod and I could feel a little small fish or something on the end. And having braid gives me the benefit of doing that. Look at that. My bait was absolutely smashed. And while I was talking to you, I was sure that a fish had picked that up and taken that. It was just the fact that we're obviously talking and I was a little bit distracted that I didn't pick straight up into the bite. But it's a really good example of having that braid allowed me to see everything that was going on there. With mono, I could have sat there for 3, 4, 5 minutes and then wound in and had a smashed bait. And like I said, if I'd have been paying attention, I'm sure I would have picked up onto that quicker. But the braid itself allowed that to happen. So that was really nice. And it's a really good sign for my day as well, because the bites have started coming so much quicker. And this is what I love about braid fishing. I love getting into the zone, try and read in the tip, try and see what's happening. I'm just tweaking it there a little bit quicker, look, doing everything a little bit quicker, tightening everything up that little bit nicer. and then I can just sit and pay attention straight away. So this time I am going to pay attention. Look at that movement straight away. There's obviously a few roach who've just moved into the peg. They can be a little bit awkward to hit, especially if they're small fish. Just missed that one as well. Can't believe it. Two bites in a row. Unbelievable. Maybe I'm getting a bit keen. Maybe that's what it is. So, see, we've swung this in. This time, bait's not touched. So I just needed to be a little bit more patient there. I should have maybe let that bite develop a little bit. Maybe just getting a little bit keen on myself, carried away. Nothing wrong with that though, I don't think. I like to be a bit enthusiastic with what I'm doing. Helps me get into it a little bit. Cast back out, get the peg going, get a little bit of action there. Remember, I'm not sitting and waiting for bream today. I'm trying to fish for everything that swims, get lots of bites in my peg. Don't mind missing a bite or two. Obviously, I don't want to miss too many. But the idea is with this braid, I can see exactly what's going on. I've actually set up a braid direct rod as well. So maybe I might even make a tweak to that just to have a go, just to see if that makes any difference in a little while. But we'll see what happens here. See if we get another quick bite or indication. I actually prefer it when bites come after like 30 seconds to sort of like a couple of minutes. I always feel like if you sort of get those crazy bites straight away like we just did, I think that is often when you miss them. I think they come down, they chase the feeder, there's a bit of chaos going on and you don't just quite get that lucky hook hold. Whereas when you've just let the peg settle after the feeder's hit the bottom, so any time from now, if I was to get an indication or a bite, I would certainly feel like I'd have a much greater chance of hitting that bite. Let's see if anything comes. Maybe we can just get it to settle down. Just tweaking that braid there. Look at that little tiny, tiny indication on the tip. Just a little sort of tighten up, if you like. Look. See that bite there? Obviously, I can read exactly what's going on. Not going to pick up on him. Wasn't 100% sure what that was. I would probably guess a fish probably just picking up the bait but not quite hooking itself. So that could have quite easily been another one of those wind in and nothing there jobs, which you can get. So I'm just going to wait, going to be a little bit more patient. Obviously, just these smaller fish are proving a little bit more tricky today. Not quite feeding positively yet. But by having that braid on my rod, I can read that. I can see what's going on. I can see these indications. You know, we might have to make an adjustment, maybe put double pinky on, something like that. We might have to put a smaller hook on. Look, another again, little indications. Definitely little small fish in the peg this. Definitely something not right with my peg at the moment. So I just need to have a little think. I just need to try and figure out what I'm going to do. And you can see there, that's brilliant. If the camera just zooms in on that there, that is the problem that I'm having right now. So look, just the very end of the maggot has been nipped off. That is no doubt little small tiny fish that have come into the peg and they're actually nicking my maggot off. So tell you what I'm going to do, I'm going to put a couple of pinkies on. Now pinkies are of course a smaller bait, so hopefully if a fish takes the bait, there's a much better chance of it actually sucking in the hook as well if it is a small fish. And it's really interesting how something like this can develop in my peg. I'm actually quite pleased it's happened for you on camera, because a lot of the time when we go out, the session goes really smoothly. So I like a bit of a challenge. I like having something like this. You know, it's only 10-15 minutes where it hasn't gone my way. So let's see if a little change to pinkies has any effect. Hopefully we'll start hitting a few bites. Gonna tighten that tip up a bit quicker now. Look, tightening that tip right up. Letting that braid all sort of tighten up. Again, little bite indication there. Tell you, something's happening here. Not the smoothest of sessions, gotta admit. Look, and not, even then my pinkies have been taken off the hook. So we must be talking about some really tiny fish out there. Just stripping my bait. Quite interesting, to be honest. Not something that I've suffered a lot with, but it is just causing me a little problem today. Let's try again. Determined to get to the bottom of it. Sink the rod, let the feeder hit the bottom, drag the feeder rod back onto the rod rest. I'm gonna have to concentrate this time, aren't I? Instead of talking to you guys. Well, we're attached to something. That bite has come straight away. Now it feels like a bigger fish. And that could be the difference. That could be the difference on what's just happened there. Couple of pinkies, some regular casting. There was some small fish there. Maybe it's just attracted a better fish in and it's just pushed these smaller fish out of the way. What have we got here? The quickness of the bite. This could be an F1. This could be an F1. I'm suspecting it is an F1 as well. Look at that. Oh, what a result. What an absolute result. So you've just seen me go through the pain. An absolute horror. 10 minutes. Missing bites, little fish in the peg, a little tweak there to the two fluoro pinkies, and that is the result. What an absolutely cracking F1 on this braid setup. I said to you that I felt the fish were funny. I said something wasn't going right there. Something wasn't working for me in the peg. Let's just see if we can hold him up for you, because he is an absolute beauty. And a little curl. Let's just hook the rod up. That is an absolute beauty, cracking looking fish in this lake. The water's so clear. Come on, mate. There we go, look. What an absolutely beautiful F1. Probably near on 2 pound, pop him in the net. But it just goes to show what I was saying. I felt there was some little fish there. I felt something wasn't right. I was missing bites, everything was wrong. I hadn't really missed hardly any bites earlier in the session, and that's obviously because that F1, or maybe a couple of F1s, had come in and unsettled the fish. They were snatching at the bait and I was missing bites as a result. But by working hard, I've actually fooled an F1 on the drop. It's as the feeder hit the bottom, the rod went straight round there, and I've managed to put a 2-pounder in the net. So that was certainly zero to hero there in the space of 10 minutes. Gonna get back on with this session. Let's see how we get on. So I'm really having an interesting session here, and this is what I love about coming to a place like this. You just don't know how your day is going to turn. Last time you joined me, we were going through a sort of frustrating period, really, where we were missing a few bites from small fish. And as it turned out, there was some sort of F1 there that had unsettled the fish. And then all of a sudden, everything's just settled down. Everything's just gone a bit quieter. And my last 5 or 6 fish have actually been skimmers. Nice fish, you know, up to about 1.5 pounds. And it just goes to show the difference and how your peg can change at any one time. And actually, I sort of made a conscious decision, really, because I was using the braid, I could see all the indications from the roach. I could see almost like the chaos. And by casting in regularly, I was happily keeping those roach there. So I just promised myself I'd put a bigger hook bait on, promised myself I'd just sit a little bit more patient, and hopefully, because I wasn't casting so regularly, those roach would drift away. And that's kind of what's happened. It's now, the peg's changed. Now I'm definitely not getting anywhere near as many indications as I was. You know, I can see that clearly on the tip, and the bites that I am getting are much more positive indications and pickups from skimmers. It's not, you know, you're not gonna get bites straight away like you do with roach. Like I said before, I felt the roach were following the feeder down, attacking the bait that was there, and then they were swimming off. But I actually cut out a lot of the loose feed. I didn't put any loose feed in the feeder because I just felt that it was causing the roach to be a little bit active, and by just sitting a little bit more patient, it hasn't taken long for those roaches to drift away. And now I can sort of wait 2, 3, 4 minutes at a time before then getting a more positive indication or a positive bite from a skimmer. And if you don't get one, no problem. You know, we can work and cast in again and take it from there. So by using that braid, it's been really interesting. I also, incidentally, have changed the rod that's got the braid direct to the feeder. Now, the reason I did that was because those small roach and fish that were in the peg were frustrating me a little bit, and I was missing a few bites. But I went on a tremendous run where I caught sort of 10 or 12 roach straight away, and I was on the braid direct rod. Did it make a massive difference? Well, I suppose it'll always be hard to say. It might just be that the fish became a little bit more settled in the peg, but all I know is I did put that run of fish together. And when we've got that rig on, that lovely rig with a power gum in it, it just means I can fish with the braid direct and still not be worried about any bigger fish giving me any serious problems or breaking the line. So I thought I'd probably take this opportunity to talk to you a little bit about braid and spooling it up on the reel and things like that, because I know that there's probably a few bits of information out there and you've probably heard a few things. Like, I remember when I first started, you gotta soak it in water for 24 hours, do a voodoo dance, and then obviously pray for the best when it goes on the reel. Unfortunately, I think times have changed a little bit from the early days of braid fishing, when maybe you did have to do things like soak it or wind it through some water. The absolute feeder braid actually comes as a coated braid. It's got a coating on it, so there's absolutely no need whatsoever to do anything like wind it in from a bucket of water or anything else. The only thing that I always like to do with any line when I'm winding it in is actually have it so it's in a bucket and it can spin freely as I wind it, just because I think that always takes a bit of twist out. But it's not the end of the world, it'll come out with a cast or two anyway. So all I do when I'm ever loading up braid is I get a spool of the feeder braid and make sure that, you got to remember, braid's very thin, so I make sure that the spool is quite full of backing line or tape or something like that, because braid is a lot thinner than mono, it doesn't take up as much space. And then just wind it steadily onto the spool. Now, like I said, you'll probably have a little bit of a red coating on your fingers from the coating on the braid, which is great to see, because it just means the braid's all working nicely. And generally speaking with braid, yes, braid isn't as cheap as mono, but it lasts for ages. I've actually had this feeder braid on my reels for about 5 years, because a couple of the reels are the original test samples of the braid, and they're as good as this sort of braid that's been on a year. You know, it really does keep a long time, so you don't have to worry too much about replacing it often. So it probably even works out better value, if you like, than a normal mono, which is one of the reasons why it's nice to use. Now, just a smooth wind when you're putting it on. I always like to hold the line when I'm winding line onto a reel. It is very important. And you can see there, I haven't overloaded this spool. It's full without being sort of crazy full, if you like. It's probably a mil or two down from the top, which is the perfect balance on the reel. It means that it's not going to spew off the reel too quickly and cause me any problem with wind knots. You probably remember that I said to you that I like to use 012, a little bit thicker braid, and it just means when it's a bit thicker, all those sort of problems become obsolete, really. But that's a really nice thing to do. You don't have to worry at all about, like I said, chucking it in water. But as time goes on, that coating will wear off the braid. But as it wears off the braid, the use and the fact that it's been in the water and all that will make the braid into probably even better product in the end as well. So don't worry about it. If you want to give braid a go, just get yourself some and pop it on straight on your spool. You shouldn't have any issues. Another point worth mentioning is when you actually get onto the bank, braid itself it needs to be wet in order to be used properly. So obviously, like I said before, we've had got the coatings on the braid, which does help, and it helps it not stick. Effectively, what happens is the braid sort of sticks to itself a little bit, and when the braid is sticking to itself, as it pulls off the spool, if it pulls off unevenly, you can get a few knots. So as a precaution, I always like to spray my spool of my reel with water to make sure that the braid is really wet before that first cast. It just seems to be that everything's a little bit more smooth and nice when that happens. So don't, you know, just try that. Make sure that your braid has been wetted. Obviously, after you've had one cast, it's not a problem anyway. If you don't carry an atomizer with you, clip a bomb on before the start and just chuck your braid out and leave it in the water for a little while. And when your braid's in the water for a little while, obviously that's going to help and soften it up. So when you get fishing at the start of the match, it's going to be perfect to use. That's a really useful tip when using braid on the reel. One thing that I am going to just touch on is the type of feeders that I'm using today, because I suppose the question that needs to be asked is, do you need a different type of feeder when you're fishing with braid? And the simple answer is no, you don't. You don't need to change the type of feeder you use just because you're fishing with braided line. So for me, and some noisy ducks. So for me, I can use all the usual feeders that I want to use in my fishing, and I can utilize them to get the benefits out of them. So just to give you a few examples of what I've got on my tray, you've probably seen me fishing with this quite a bit today. First of all, the old caged window. That way I'm looking to get most of the bait down to the bottom, protected by the window feeder, but little bits breaking off with the cage. When it's down on the bottom, generally with the window feeder, a bit of a slower release. You can see here I've got the bullet. Now when you have a wire bullet, there's obviously hardly any protection to the bait whatsoever. So a lot of your bait breaks up and comes out on the way down, forming a totally different sort of presentation. And that same thing applies to the cage feeder in wire as well. Of course, I'd use a bullet feeder most of the time if I could, because the bullet feeder is a lot more accurate. I do love a cage feeder, but once you start casting any particular distance, they're not as good as a bullet. And then I've got the plastic bullet, which obviously then adds a bit more protection, and you can see there carries a lot more ground bait than the window. So I can still use all those usual feeders that I want to use, all the usual types of feeder that I think might be good, but it's basically I'm using the braid to dictate and see what happens in my peg a lot more. And just while I've been talking to you, I've noticed I've had two or three little indications. I think we've definitely come to the time of the day when I need to be a bit more patient. I think there's a chance of an odd bigger fish, a chance of an odd skimmer. Put the rod back on the double rest, get the stopwatch set up, be patient for those for those bites, and those sorts of things can happen. Just had a small roach on there, don't know if he's still hanging on or not, but effectively I can put the rod back on the rest and be a bit more patient. Let's see if he's hanging on still. He's not, unfortunately not. You'd think he would be, wouldn't you, but he's not playing games. Maggot's absolutely obliterated. Typical, isn't it? First time you put it back on the rest. But that's what you need to look for. You need to be able to tell what's happening in your peg. Looked to me like it had gone quiet. Obviously not. I saw that indication there. Hopefully we can put another fish in the net this time. But basically, to summarise that, you don't need to be thinking about changing your feeders because you're fishing with braid. I've just had a cage feeder on there for five or six chucks just to try and make something happen again. So I'm just going to clip the window feeder back on, the little 20 gram cage window. I'm just going to wedge a little bit of bait in there, a little bit of a slower release of my bait. Hopefully that'll result in a fish a little bit quicker. Let's just see. Nice to get an odd better fish as well today. Just, you know, there's been a few. I've had like some better hybrids and fish like that. You know, even on the braid, if you've got balanced tackle, you've got a chance of getting these better fish out. So, you know, this rig, the soft rod, you hook these better fish, take your time, and the result will be a nice fish in the net, absolutely. There he is, look, a nice one, that one. Here he is, look, nice skimmer, finding the net. Absolutely beautiful, absolutely beautiful. Oh, hook's even come out. There he is, look. Beauty. I suppose one of the interesting questions is going to be, when would you want to use braid over mono? I think a lot of that depends on you as an angler and, you know, on your experiences. I've spoken to a lot of people and this really does apply for me. You know, I love using braid. I love fishing with braid. You can see that I've just chucked that out, and as the feeder's hit the bottom, I've caught a roach straight away. I could see the tip jagging straight away there, and that's because I have the braid on. And now I can feel every single fin kick of this fish all the way back. And I think as part of as a fishing experience, that's quite enjoyable. So I really do like using braid in that respect. You know, like roach like this, perfect braid fish. And I would say if you're targeting fish like this on a natural venue or even on a commercial, then braid can be a really good tool to use, not just to enjoy the day, but also to see what's happening and catch more fish. You know, I knew straight away then that fish was on and I could just wind it in. I think if you're fishing for bigger fish, or if you're fishing for, you know, carp or anything that's quite aggressive, there just isn't the need to use braid. But I will say there is a big advantage to using braid on any venue where you're targeting these sort of smaller fish. I really do think it can add something to your fishing. I mean, I love going fishing in Ireland, for example, and just to give you a good idea, when I go to Ireland, I don't even take reels with mono on. I only take reels with braided lines on, because I know that braid is going to make a big impact to my fishing and make it better. So that is why and when I would probably use braid, and certainly look to be getting an advantage from it. You know, straight away I can see there's little indications and I can read everything. It's just, it really has made a big difference today. We've had frustrating spells of missing bites and just not happening, but I was always confident that it would come round, and I could at least tell what was happening and I could understand it. And we've had a brilliant run now where we've put F1s, skimmers, loads of roach in the net. It's just been a really enjoyable session. And I think all of that has been enhanced and made better by using this braid. So I wanna really conclude the braid chat by talking about how you go about reading the bites on your tip. Now, if you've never fished with braid before, it's completely different to mono in terms of the bites and the indications you're gonna see. For a start off, you're gonna see everything, okay? Now look, straight away there's little taps on the tip. Look, quick indications, bites. So I'm seeing everything that's going on. That small roach in the peg at the moment. So a nice time to sort of like tell you what's happening. So you saw that, and I'm just tweaking the tip. I'm just tweaking it to stay in contact with it the whole time. But look, I could pick up straight away there that there was some small bites from roach as that feeder hit the bottom. Now, I don't believe that the fish ever had that hook in its mouth. It was a small fish. It was attacking the bait. And I got to see that happen. Now, with mono, I definitely wouldn't have seen that. So there could be a chance now that my bait is actually damaged. So because I've seen that indication early on, I'm not gonna look, and that tip, that bite is developed properly. So I got to watch that bite develop properly there. And the sensitivity of braid just exaggerated everything that happened. So I knew when it started to go and shake properly that I was going to get that better bite. But it was really the perfect example of how to read the bite. The first one, the small two or three taps, nothing. And then even when the bite developed, you noticed I didn't pick up straight away. I just let it happen so I could see that the fish was definitely on. And there he is, look, a skimmer, perfectly in the mouth. That was a brilliant example of how to read the bite on braid, and how by using braid, you can get so much more from it. You can get so much more read and feel for what's going on. A great example. Well, an absolutely brilliant day feeder fishing with braid here at Bank End Fishery. I've had a cracking mixed bag, loads of ropes, silvers, odd bream, couple of F1s, what not to like. I hope you've taken some great tips from this. Get out there, give it a go for yourself.